And there has also been a kind of collapse of recognition of professionalism within that sector as well, in some places. So the result of that is that you have a degree of WE. You can do it on the side perhaps, but we're not going to make a degree of that. So I think that that comes back as well to trade union density and how do you re-establish a balance in the labour market without having collectively bargained minimums. I think that they're actually key. Okay, thank you. I'm sorry for the very broad questions.
Of course, it's more reflections than questions, but thank you for your question. I think for the first question you mentioned, I think you're right. So what we consider as agency factors in the union's reactions are in fact structural because they are linked to the regulatory framework about the anti-trust law and so on. So I think you're right to a certain extent. But what we want to capture here is the idea that are there debates within the institutions, within the unions, concerning these questions. So, for example, in France and in Belgium, the two countries in which, for the moment, the doors are closed, they are, of course, internal debates around that. And they say, and they are local initiatives. They take local initiatives, for example, at a very local level, for stores, general stores, they say, okay, we have to consider all people belonging to the same store or linked professionally to the store. So they try to and that's, in that way we consider that they begin to open the door and then can be viewed as an agency strategy. But you're right, I think it's mostly linked to structural factors. Concerning the necessity to take into account the sectors, I also agree, of course. And we have plenty of examples, especially when considering the social dialogue. For example, in the journalist area, you have very powerful professional associations. And as you will see this afternoon, we'll discuss that. So the idea that in some countries, these professional associations are able to build coalitions with the unions, with well-established unions. And they are able to extend the collective bargaining system to their members by analogy to a certain extent. So it shows that in some sectors, like the journalism area, or again, you mentioned, of course, your sector as an artist. In Belgium, for example, we have a very specific status for that, so, meaning that they can benefit from an employment allowance, provided that they have a certain number of days working and so on, but this kind of system doesn't exist in other countries. It shows that if we want to refine the reflection about that, we have to adopt a much more detailed consideration and indeed take into consideration the sectors as variables that can explain the level of social protection. So thank you for your question. Other questions, comments, questions? Valeria, Mia.
Well, first of all, thank you very much. It's a very interesting, not only the presentation now, but also this morning. So it's really fascinating to see all this kind of bunch of knowledge you are giving to us. Well, it is a bit linked to the point raised before, but I will raise it from another side. Well, I agree with you regarding particularly, you know, your conclusions. I completely, in line with that. I just have an issue regarding the way how I understand, but I might understand it wrong, the way how you tackle the issue of trade union resilience. So I don't know how you really define it, and probably you can shape more the kind of frame or variables whatsoever that you consider it when you kind of conceive the idea of trade union inclusivenesses. Because if we actually think that trade union inclusivenesses is linked only to trade union density and coverage of collective bargaining, we are wrong. And that's exactly. So I would like to probably say a bit more on that. Because the issue is also when we consider coverage of collective bargaining. I mean, we all know that these two things, trade union density and coverage, they don't go together. They are actually very much not dependent from each other. We also see that this also because in most of the cases, that is a structural factor, we face a sort of changes in the kind of strategy, or I would say structures of coordination of collective bargaining. And this is another important element that probably, I don't know whether you have come across in your analysis, which is quite interesting for me, because in fact, this coverage mostly kind of also depends on where you bargain. More enterprise level bargaining might in fact, let's say, reduce or increase coverage, as well as, and we have to say that, employers' willingness and or structures of organizations for bargaining can also have an impact, you know, on this kind of issue. So these are in fact kind of structural factors that might, I don't know, also give, you know, kind of further possibilities to reflect and explain why. And then I close here to say that, in fact, because when we talk about collective bargaining agreement, this is just an agreement between two parties. And it is not automatic that if an individual, let's say, is a member of a union, but if he has a job in a context where there is no collective bargaining, he doesn't get anything out of it. So that's what I wanted to make sure. And there we go back again to structures rather than more willingness, rational choice, and whatsoever by the unions. Yeah.
Okay, so.
Thank you, Valeria, for your question. She's a specialist in industrial systems, so I am challenged by the question. A very quick answer. So concerning what we call the agency, the inclusiveness of union strategies, we just consider it to membership. So are they open to a membership of self-employed people or not? So we consider that if, for example, in the Netherlands, self-employed people can be members of a union, it's not the case in France, and it's not the case in Belgium. So that's what we call exclusive versus inclusive strategy. And we consider that as an agency factor because it's a question of, I would say, political behavior of the unions rather than, even if I perfectly agree with you that there are structural factors that can explain that by welcoming self-employed workers you can also integrate entrepreneurs that can be considered as such by the anti-competition law and so on. But in most European countries, unions are open to the idea that self-employed workers, solo self-employed workers with multiple job holding positions are in fact workers and not entrepreneurs. And this is what we call inclusiveness. Okay? So that's the way in which we will show this problem. I received some signs from the board. Are you hungry, maybe?
Yes.
So, you explain the rules?
Yes. Sorry, so it's we're a bit late on schedule, that's why I'm interrupting, sorry. Basically, lunch is right behind you. Please serve yourself, eat wherever you want, here around. And.